Good day all, and welcome once again to my YouTube channel. So today we are going to be having a class on chemistry, and the topic is acids, bases, salts and water. Now, so many students, they have issues with this topic, acid, bases, salts and water, but I will try my possible best to make sure that I'm able to explain everything concerning the concept of acids, bases, salts and water. All right? So you just pay attention as I start the class. Now this video, we are going to be having two series of videos on this topic. Okay, so the first part of the video will be on acids and bases. Then while the other part of the video will be salts and water. So now let's understand the concept of acids and bases. Now listen. Scientists were able to come up with their definitions of acids and bases. But mind you, I can say about four scientists came together to, you know, postulate their different definitions of acids and bases, of which they brought three definitions. So it's obvious that two of the scientists came together to postulate or define acids and bases. Then while the other two, they gave their separate definitions. So we're having three definitions of acids and bases. And who were these scientists? The first scientist is Arrhenius. Arrhenius. So is Svante Arrhenius. Then while the second scientist is Johannes, there are about two of them, Johannes Bronsted and Thomas Lorry. Johannes Bronsted and Thomas Lorry. They came together and then they gave the definition of acids and bases. Then the last scientist that came with his definition was Gilbert Newton Lewis. Gilbert Newton Lewis. Now these men, they were able to define acids into different perspectives. Now the first man that defined acid was Svante Arrhenius. Now according to Svante Arrhenius, he said that acids are substances when dissolved in water produces hydrogen ion or hydronium ion as the only positive ion. That was his definition, and that is the definition that so many students know about acids, but that is not the only definition of acids. See what this man was trying to explain. Now let's say you are having a container containing water. Let's say you have H2O in this container. Now if you turn a substance that is an acid into this container, it tends to produce H plus in the container, and this H plus that is produced is indicating that you have just added acid to the water. So the limitation of Svante Arrhenius' definition was that without water you won't know if a substance is an acid or not. All right, so then again, these two men came together and then they were able to define acids as proton donor. Acids as proton donors. Then they define bases as proton acceptors. Acids as proton donors and bases as proton acceptors. Remember that the symbolic representation of proton is H plus, which is also called hydrogen ion. So it means that if a substance is able to accept proton, then it fits in this these two main definition of acid. For example, if I'm having a substance A plus H plus, and then it gives me AH, and then I'm having AH to giving me A plus, or rather A plus H plus, something like this. In this case, this substance is accepting proton. So you can call this substance a base. And then while this one is donating proton, meaning after dissociation, so you can call this an acid. So you can call this Bronsted-Lorry's base while you refer to this as Bronsted-Lorry's acid. So that's just the concept. And from Svante Arrhenius' definition of acids, he said that acids are substances when dissolved in water, produces hydrogen ion. Then also for bases, they are simply substances when dissolved in water, they produce hydroxide ion, hydroxide ion. That's talking about the OH minus. Of course, you should know that that's a radical. You know, when you have a group of atoms with charge, they are considered as radicals, okay? So we have seen two definitions of acids and bases. Then let's see the last definition. Now, for G.L. Lewis, Gilbert Newton Lewis' definition of acids, he defined acids as electron pair acceptors, and he defined bases as electron pair donors. Okay, so please, you need to understand the definitions of acids and bases by these different men that gave their definitions. The first, Svante Arrhenius, he defined acids as substances when dissolved in water, produces hydrogen ion as the only positive ion, and bases, they produce hydroxide ion as the negative ion. Then in the case of the Johannes Bronsted and Thomas Lorry, Bronsted Lorry for short, okay, they defined acids as proton donors. And remember, proton is H plus and bases as proton acceptors. Then lastly, Gilbert Newton Lewis gave his definition of acids, and then he said that they are electron pair acceptors, then while bases are electron pair donors. So the detail of this Gilbert Newton Lewis definition will be seen in our later classes, okay? But mind you, let's start by dealing with acids. Now, looking at acids, we have two divisions or two classes of acids. So let's start by dealing with the classes of acids. Now, what are the classes of acids? Now, the first we have is, we have the inorganic. We have inorganic acids, and then we have organic acids. So we have inorganic and organic acids. Now, when we talk about inorganic acids, we are simply referring to acids that are formed by the simple combination of inorganic mineral elements. And of course, we have them to also be referred to as mineral acids. Okay, that's another name for inorganic acids. Alright, so classical examples of inorganic acids include, we have the HCl, talking about the hydrochloric acid, we have the H2SO4, then we also have the HNO3, amongst others. Then looking at the organic acids, classical examples of organic acids include, we have the fatty acids, we have the citric acids, we have ascorbic acids, then we also have ethanoic acids, then we also have amino acids, amongst others, even the lactic acids. Okay, now of course you know that this one is found exclusively in fats and oils. It's present in fats and oils. Okay, then while this one is found in lime and lemon, can find citric acid there, and then ascorbic acid is found in oranges. Please, never should you mistake the acid present in oranges for the acid present in lime and lemon, because you know that oranges are under the citrus family. Don't mistake the acid that is found there. You can still always remember that ascorbic acid is the acid that is found in oranges. Then while this one is found in vinegar, that's ethanoic acid, this one is found in protein materials, then while this one is found in milk, okay? So these are organic acids. And mind you, organic acids usually occur in naturally occurring substances. They usually are present in plants as well as animal materials, okay? Then for these ones, they are usually synthesized artificially, probably in the lab, you understand? So these are the classes. There are two classes, don't forget. And we have, based on the nature with which the acid dissociates in solution, we are having two types of acids. And what are they? We have the strong acids. We have strong acids and we have weak acids. Strong acids and weak acids. Strong acids and we have weak acids. Now, when we talk about strong acids, we are simply referring to acids. They are acids that ionize or dissociate the ionize or dissociate completely in solutions. Then while these ones, they are acids that ionize or dissociate partially in solutions. Okay, so they are acids that ionize or dissociate partially in solution. The keywords here are completely and partially. Okay, and classical examples of strong acids include the H2SO4, the HNO3, the HClO4, the HCl, amongst others. Then while we have classical examples of weak acids, we have ethanoic acid. Basically, organic acids are considered as weak acids. So this is an example of organic acid. Then we also have inorganic acids such as the phosphoric acid, H3PO4. We have the carbonic acid, H2CO3. We have the H2SO3, okay? So amongst others. So these are classical examples of acids that dissociate partially in solutions, all right? So now, never should you mistake, because this is the concept that so many students get, they have wrong mentality about. Listen, weak acids shouldn't be mistaken for dilute acids. So please, never should you mistake weak acids for dilute acids. They are not the same. When we say dilute acids, we are simply referring to acids that you have a low amount or concentration of the acid in the solution. So you have more water and less acid. So it's just like you having two containers, and in these two containers, you have, let's say, in this container, you're having 90 ml of acid. And in this other container, you're having 10 ml of acid and 90 ml of water. In this first one, you're having 90 ml of acid and 10 ml of water. Of course, it's obvious that this first container that contains a high volume of acid is considered to be concentrated. So this is concentrated, while this one is what? Dilute. So in dilute acids, you have less of the volume of the acid and more of water. Then while in concentrated, you have more of the volume of acids and less of the volume of water. That's concentrated, okay? So never should you mistake weak acids for dilute. And many students, they have this wrong mentality that when you say an acid is weak, it simply means that the acid is not corrosive. No. Whether an acid is weak or strong, if it is concentrated, it is very, very corrosive. So that's one fact that you need to take cognizance of. Then the next concept on acids that we are about looking at would be on the basicity of acids. The basicity of acids. When we talk about basicity of acids, we are referring to the number of replaceable hydrogen ions, the number of replaceable hydrogen ions present in one molecule of an acid. The number of replaceable hydrogen ions present in one molecule of an acid is considered to be called the basicity. Examples. Let's say we have HCl. Now, the number of ionizable hydrogens here, or replaceable hydrogens here, happens to be 1. So in this case, you call this a monobasic acid. Monobasic. Mono stands for 1, okay? And the basicity is just 1 there. Then when you have H2SO4, this is a dibasic acid. If you have H3PO4, this is a tribasic acid. Tribasic. Then if you have this one, CH3COOH. Please, I guess so many students will be tempted to counting the total number of hydrogens in this compound and then writing tetrabasic there, but that's very wrong. Now, in another organic acid like this, please never should you count the total number of hydrogens. The only hydrogen that can be replaced in such acid is the hydrogen present in the functional group, being COOH. So the only hydrogen that can be replaced is this one. Hence, it is called monobasic. So please, never should you count the total number of hydrogen when you have compounds like this. that usually ends with COOH. So that is actually the basicity of acids. All right. So now the next concept that we look at on acids, I just want to be brief about it, is the physical properties, of acids. Now, for the physical properties of acids, the first physical property of acid is that acids turn blue litmus paper red. So you can even use a code to remembering it, that is BRA, meaning blue to red is acid. Okay, then number two, you know that litmus paper happens to be an indicator. All right, you know litmus paper in an acidic solution is red, and in a basic solution is blue, then in a neutral solution is purple. All right, so take cognizance of that. In an acidic solution is red, in a basic solution is blue, in a neutral solution is purple. Then secondly, dilute acids have sour taste. Dilute acids have sour taste. Now, interestingly, the word acid came from a Greek word called acidos. And acidos in Greek means something that is sour, all right? So that's where they coined it from. Hence, dilute acids, they have sour taste. Of course, you know, you and I cannot taste concentrated acid. All right. Then number three, we have concentrated forms of acids, whether weak or strong, of acids are corrosive. Concentrated forms of acids are corrosive. All right. Then number four, acids have pH values less than 7. Don't worry, the concept of pH scale, or pH rather, will be treated in subsequent classes, and then get to know much about pH, talking about the pH scale that ranges from 0 to 14, and then coming downwards, you are increasing the level of acidity, going upwards, you are increasing the level of alkalinity or basicity, and at the point of 7 is neutrality, being the neutral point. So these are the physical features of acids. So let's consider the chemical features of acids. Now, for the chemical properties of acids, we have chemical features, also called chemical reactions. So the chemical reactions of acids. Number one. Now, reaction with bases. Now, acids tend to react with bases to form salt and water only. That reaction is called neutralization reaction. Okay? So it's called neutralization reaction. A reaction between an acid and a base to form salt and water only. And then, of course, you might be having something like this. An acid being H2SO4 plus a base being sodium hydroxide. And then, of course, this will react with this to form Na2SO4. Then water. Then balancing the reaction, we have three hydrogens, we have one sulfur, three hydrogens, two hydrogens, so you leave that one and then move to the next, because you have an odd number and even number there. So this one, and then this how many oxygen? Four here, plus one, five. Four plus one is five. Then sodium here happens to be one, or here is two, so you have to make it two. You have affected both the oxygen and the hydrogen here. You have two oxygen and two hydrogen. Let's count the total number of hydrogens now. Two here, two, that's four. So you can make this one two, that's four. Okay, everything becomes balanced in that your oxygen is two plus four, six, four plus two, six, four hydrogen, then two sodium, one sulfur, everything is balanced. So this is a classical example of neutralization reaction, because this is an acid and this is a base, and this is salt and water. Then another reaction that acids undergo is reaction with metals. Reaction with metals. Now, whenever acids react with metals, they tend to liberate hydrogen gas. But now, it's not all acids that tend to carry out that function. With the exception of nitric acid, HNO3. Now, HNO3 does not liberate hydrogen when reacted with metals. The reason is because it is a strong oxidizing agent. So almost immediately when it is liberating hydrogen gas, it tends to oxidize the hydrogen gas, thus forming water. All right, but other acids can do that. So we can react magnesium with sulfuric acid to give us MgSO4 plus H2. All right, so this is magnesium metal reacting with this acid to form salt and hydrogen gas is liberated. Then you could also have zinc metal reacting with HCl, and then to give you zinc chloride plus H2. All right, so when you balance it, of course you have two chlorines there, two here, and then automatically the thing is balanced. All right, so this is actually reaction of metals. But mind you, the metals that you are working with here must be highly electropositive, meaning less electropositive metals cannot liberate hydrogen gas even when they are reacted with acids. For example, this kind of reaction cannot proceed. It can't proceed. The reason is because copper is less electropositive, so it's unable to displace hydrogen, because hydrogen is higher in the activity series than copper. All right, so then the next reaction is reaction with triazocarbonate. Reaction with triazocarbonate. Now, acids generally react with triazocarbonate to liberate carbon 4 oxide gas. They react with triazocarbonate to liberate carbon 4 oxide gas. And you could be having this acid HCl plus Na2CO3. So when you carry out the reaction, you obtain a salt, NaCl plus water plus CO2. So we're trying to balance in the reaction. Here is 2 and here is 2, because we have 2 chlorine and 2 chlorine, 2 sodium, 2 sodium, and then 1 carbon there, 3 oxygen, 3 oxygen, and then 2 hydrogens, 2 hydrogens, so everything is balanced. So you see the gas that is being liberated here, which is CO2. All right, so whenever acids react with triazocarbonate, they usually liberate CO2. So that is the chemical reaction of acids. Let's quickly look at the laboratory preparation of acids. Laboratory preparation of acids. Now, looking at the laboratory preparation of acids, now we have several means that we can prepare acids in the lab. One of them includes the dissolution of acid and hydrides, the dissolution of acid and hydrides in water. Dissolution of acid and hydrides in water. When we talk about acid and hydrides, what comes to your mind? Now, acid and hydrides are simply oxides of non-metals. They are oxides of non-metals that dissolve in water to form acids. A classical examples of this acid and hydrides includes, we have NO2, we have SO2, we have SO3, we have CO2. So working with these acid and hydrides, for example, let's say we work with CO2, it gives you H2CO3. This is an acid and it's called carbonic acid, the weak one at that. Then if we work with SO2, now SO2 plus H2O gives you H2SO3. This is also a weak acid, okay? And then we also have H2O plus NO2 to give HNO2 plus HNO3. Observe this critically. You'd notice that in this case, this one, after dissolving in water, it formed two acids. We have the nitrous and the nitric acid. So that's the reason why amongst these, the only one that is referred to as a mixed acid and hydride is this one. A question has been asked on this before, I think in JAM. And then they said, which of the following is referred to as a mixed acid and hydride? It is actually NO2, that is nitrogen 4 oxide, a mixed acid and hydride. All right, so that's one way that you can prepare acids in the lab. Then another way that you can prepare acids is simply the combination of constituent elements. Combination of constituent elements. Yes, that can also be another way that you can prepare inorganic acids. And examples include, you have hydrogen gas. Let's say we want to prepare hydrochloric acid. Hydrogen gas are reacting with chlorine gas. Both of them, they happen to be gases. And then to increase the reaction rate, you can work with activated charcoal, and then you obtain hydrogen chloride gas. Now, this hydrogen chloride gas, when dissolved in water, it will now give you hydrochloric acid, an aqueous solution of hydrochloric acid. So that's another way that you can obtain acids or prepare it in the lab. Then lastly, another method of preparing acids in the lab includes, now you could be having the you want to prepare a weak acid from a strong acid. What you simply do is that you use a strong acid to preparing a weak acid by simply displacing the weak acid from its salt. How? For example, let's say we are having H2SO4, and then you want to prepare, you want to prepare this acid, that's phosphoric acid, that is H3PO4, now plus CaSO4. Now observe this critically. You get to know that this is a strong acid, and this is a weak acid. You have not balanced the reaction. Now, weak acids can be prepared from strong acids by simply displacing the weak acid from its salt, and it is only displaced by the presence of the strong acid. Of course, balancing this reaction here, we'll be having, we have aminic calcium here is 3, then of course we are having 2 hydrogens here, so we have 3 hydrogens here, and then of course you can actually make here to be 3, while you make here 2, and then that's 6. So let's confirm whether it's balanced. We have 3 sulfur, 3 and all that, and then 3 of these, then 2 phosphorus and 8. So everything is balanced. Okay, so you can actually prepare a weak acid from a strong acid by simply displacing the weak acid from its salt. All right, and then again, you can also prepare a more volatile acid from a less volatile acid by simply using the less volatile acid to displacing the more volatile acid from the salt. For example, we could have this H2SO4. H2SO4 happens to be a less volatile acid. By volatile, it means when you say volatility, a substance that has the ability to transform rapidly into gas, right? And then you want to prepare a more volatile acid from it, so you displace it from its salt, and you end up having HCl, which is the more volatile acid, and then what you are going to be left with is K2SO4. So when you try to balance in the reaction, here is 2 hydrogens, so here should be 2, everything becomes balanced. Okay, so we have just been able to displace the more volatile acid from its salt using the less volatile acid. So that's still another way of preparing volatile acids, as well as the way of preparing weak acids from strong acids. So these are some facts that you need to consider about acids. I think we are going to be, initially I said we are going to be having 2 videos, but I believe it will be 3 videos on this, or probably even more. All right, so please, if you like this video, don't forget to like, place your like there, comment, share the video, and make sure that you place your questions, anything that is bothering you can actually leave it in the comment section, and always endeavor to stay tuned to this channel, because I'll be uploading videos that will be of help to students. So thanks for watching, and God bless.